Ryan is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
I should grow up someday, 'cause I got bills to pay. I can't be waking up at someone else's place. I know I drink too much, can't pay my rent this month. I should be saving up, but I just got paid. I'm broke, but I'm borrowing. Don't know where we're going.
Here comes Wild Knight, the Intimidator lifting. Wild Knight just keeps on winning. Legado's coming now. Wessex in front. Legado's eventually getting there. She'll get there. What a win, Legado. But Defibrillate has got the Cambridge Studs Abel Classic all parceled up.
We had action of the highest quality at Pukekohe Park yesterday afternoon, and it certainly delivered, didn't it? We had Defibrillate taking out the Group 1 Zabil Classic on Boxing Day. Michael Guerin, my co-host, you were there at the track, and it was a great day, wasn't it? There was a really good atmosphere, not at the normal venue of Ellerslie, obviously, but it still didn't fail to disappoint.
It was fun, Emma. Good morning to you. Big hi to everybody watching around the country. Belated Merry Christmas, and hope those having a holiday are enjoying it. Yeah, good vibe, good fun vibe. It doesn't have the gravitas of a day at Ellerslie, but of course there's still Group 1 victories to be handed out. And in years to come, no one's really going to remember where those Group 1s or another big black type win for Legato came from. So I thought the racing really high standard, lots of swoopers. So the track obviously played incredibly fair. We've got that today. We've also got the announcement of the next two inductees into the Hall of Fame. Really cool to have people who are still in the prime of their career getting into the Hall of Fame. And later on, we'll talk to David Ellis about his good friend Colin Gillings. Colin, one of the absolute legends of New Zealand racing of all codes, a gentleman of the game, and he passed away last week, very sadly. So we'll find out a bit more about what sort of person Colin was. So it may be a break for lots of people, Em, but it's not a break for the people in racing.
No, exactly right. Everybody working hard over Christmas, of course. But let's start our reviews with that Group 1, who was obviously taken out by Defibrillate for Graham Richardson and Rogan Norvell.
She's got the job in front of her, and back with her as they turn for home is Harlech. Homeward bound in the Group 1, and it's Polly Gray being cuddled up by McNabb over on the inside from Le Sablier. The mare runs on out wide. Prix de Fer being presented, and so is Defibrillate. And behind them, Soldier Boy at the 250. Defibrillate, Prix de Fer looming large on the outside, battling away Polly Gray. It's Defibrillate in front, holding from Prix de Fer, and then followed by Polly Gray. But Defibrillate has got the Cambridge Studs Zabil Classic all parcelled up.
We've gone back to back here, and each of them in the Zabil Classic with two of your old favourites.
Yeah, they are. When they both finally retired, which Tiptronic just has, and this guy in another 5 years, I hope, he's only eight, they'll both be in the same paddock together on my property. So, yeah, very love the horse, both horses, and it's an amazing thrill for me to win them both.
For him to come home at 8 years old, did you think we'll try and win a Group 1? Or did you genuinely think he still had a Group 1 motor and, more importantly, Group 1 legs?
Absolutely. You know, that's why he came back. He sort of reached his limit a bit. You know, in Australia he could have actually won a couple more, but he would have had to be in place properly. Weight for age horses over there are a lot stronger than here. And I thought he's the ideal horse because of his rating, his handicap. I thought he's the perfect horse for New Zealand racing.
I know you think he goes best fresh. Any chance you go straight from this into a Herbie Dyke, which is 7 weeks away?
That's what he's doing, yeah. That's what he's doing. Keep the fresh legs. Give him a trial or two. I only gave him a trial this time, and one trial, and hit out at Tarapa, and it worked. You know, it's keeping him happy.
How do you do that? How do you keep a horse who's eight and he's been around those big stables and big circuits over in Australia, so he's been to the puppet show a few times. How do you keep him interested?
Oh, you just got to change his routine all the time. It's just like I don't like anything. I mean, he changes routine around and he doesn't get sour, and he's such a gentleman. When he was a young horse, he's very, very tough. And he used to buck like you wouldn't believe. So his first trolley bucked all the way up the straight. I thought, oh my God. But anyway, and it's the only time he's ever been right-handed, so he couldn't get a line on him there. So, but no, he's always been, easy to deal with, easy to train and all that.
Does he give you the feel he could be back here this time next year?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well, that's his only 30th start. So, you know, he's been looked after. Paddy did a fantastic job of him. And, hence why he's still racing. A lot of horses, you know, they can have 60, 70 starts before the 6 or 7. You know, this horse has had 30 now, so.
You know, you've won a Group 1 2,000 metre race, or in this case 2,050, every year for the last three seasons, and they're not easy races to win.
No, they're not, and that's right. It's got to sink in, but, yeah, love Mustaias. they train themselves.
Well, it's been a dream start to New Zealand Warren, but the dream just got better.
Yeah, it's been a fantastic start. It makes it so much easier when you move to new country and you get all that support and you're able to have winners and do well. It makes the move a lot easier. Now, if I wasn't doing so well, I might not be so happy, but I've been doing really well, had fantastic support, and this is just the cherry on the cake. You know, you always want to go and be competitive in the Group 1 races. That's where it really counts. And to bring one so early in my move to New Zealand, it's just fantastic. You can't ask for a better start.
He's a wonderful old horse. He's done a fair bit of hard racing in Australia. No lack of appetite there. He still wanted to be out there today.
Absolutely. He might be an old horse, but young at heart, you know. He's really, really felt good going down the start. Gave me a little bit of a fresh behind the start, feeling really good. But the key was he placed himself out the gates. You know, I was worried, would they go a bit hard earlier and drag it right up on the back stretch, because I didn't see a true pacemaker in the race. And, you know, he's also liked to chase them down. So from that draw, I was hoping to maybe get across and get one or two to lead me and have a bit of cover. And, you know, he just put himself in the right spot and he automatically relaxed with me. And he's just professional, just knows what he's there for and knows what to do. And when you ask him, the response is there. So he's just the old professional and young at heart and still got that will.
Sounds like you.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. You caught me for a bit of a loop there.
Hey, 2022, you've ended it as a Group 1 winning rider in New Zealand, Warren. You must be looking forward to 2023, because there's a very strong support base here for both you and Craig.
No, absolutely. We've both been doing really well. We've had a lot of support. The key is to get the support and to produce the goods. You know, that's what counts. And getting the first Group 1 under the belt, that proves a lot. And hopefully it'll continue to 2023. But couldn't ask for a better way to end 2022.
A big congratulations to Warren Kennedy. As he said, just a wonderful start here in New Zealand, and the cherry on the top, the Group 1, first Group 1 success on New Zealand shores. It was a really well-deserved win, wasn't it? Defoe Blake's been thereabouts in feature races coming up to yesterday, and it was good to see him deliver.
Yeah, great for Richo and for Rogan. They've now won the Herbie Dyke 2 years ago with Tiptronic, and then they won this race last year with Tiptronic. And it's not easy to win those weight for age 2,000 metre races, because they tend to be very strong. And so he had a no-excuse victory. At the line, he was going away from Prix de Feu and going away from Polly Gray. I thought Polly was fantastic. I mean, clearly she wanted the rain, which came later, to come earlier. Did a super job, never rode her well, so great to have her here. Prix de Feu had his chance. When you look at them here, he's more or less alongside Defibrillate, but at the line, Defibrillate's going away from him. And that's Prix de Feu. He's always game, always consistent. Opie couldn't have done more. He tracked the right horse into the race.
Just look, he often struggles to get the 2,000, doesn't he? He's not quite there. He finds that hard. His pet distance is sort of the 16 to the 1,800 metres, isn't it?
Yeah, and the solid tempo probably didn't help him try and get it. They went 2.5 for the 2,050 metres, and they were really rolling from the 800. Thought the mare was really good after looking like he was going to run, you know, 5th or 6th or 7th. He fought on really well for 4th. I think there's a nice enough race in the mare. He can pick up a race somewhere. Out of the race, Cinerama has been retired. So I spoke to Alan Sherrick this morning. She's obviously in Folda Tarzino. She was feeling her joints a touch. I think a lot of trainers surprised, not how firm the track was, because it wasn't bad, but they were expecting some rain to soften it over the weekend, and it didn't turn up. And he said, we were taken back a little bit by the fact that it was actually a true good track. She's been retired, had the thumps immediately after the race, so pulled out of the Queen Elizabeth Cup this Sunday at Tarapa, and she's off to be a very well-bred mum. But I thought a really good race, and I thought the best horse in the race won, a no-argument performance. When you watch that last 50 again, had they gone further, he would have won by more.
Yeah, he would. And awesome ownership group involved in Defibrillator as well. Big congratulations to them, no doubt. Some big Boxing Day celebrations after that Group 1 victory. The standout performance on the card was most definitely Legato. A stunning victory for her in the 8-carat Classic. Let's have a little look at that.
Turning for home, she's 8 lengths clear. The others getting a bit anxious at the 400. Now Skewwith looks to run on. Legato to the outside. She's looking to wind up now. Further back in the field then is Valdezoldo. It's still Wessex. Out by 6 lengths at the 200. In second spot is Skewwith. Legato's trying to wind up now. Wessex in front. She's wobbling. She leads by 2. Skewwith. Legato's coming now. Wessex in front. Legato's eventually getting there. She'll get.
Well, that was a nerve-wracking watch. Was it a nerve-wracking ride?
Well, she's jumped better than she ever has and just got the beautiful run of the race behind the second favourite. It wasn't really until you turned from 600 to the 500 and you straighten up and you realise how far off a yard is. Normal horses can't do that.
Now, what was going through your mind about coming back to Ken Kelso if you hadn't got up to win? Because it wouldn't have been a lot of fun.
I'd be lucky if he could speak as well. He gets that nervous, but he leaves me with so much confidence.
She was super over the last 100 metres. It must be fun, Ryan, riding a horse going that fast for 100 metres or 200 metres.
She's just something else. The feeling she gives when she fully stretches out on that last 100, that was just unbelievable, the feeling she gives you.
She looked pretty fit before the race. Do you think that will bring her on for the Karaka Mile?
Oh, definitely. I think Ken was stressing a little bit, and I went over twice last week just to give Ken his little bit of ease, but he's done a great job coming for the Guineas probably, 5 weeks ago now, and it just shows what a good trainer he is.
Okay, it's summertime. It's a good time to keep the weight off. 54 and a half on the 21st of January, no issues?
It's going to be touch and go, but I do it once a year, 54 and a half, and I always do it for a reason. And she's just one of those.
If you need a reason, Legato is most definitely it. She was jet propelled to the finish line. She couldn't have won. I mean, when we watched that replay, turning for home, she's so far off them. And then just that explosion, the turn of foot that she shows, where he's able to sit up over the line pretty much and cruise to victory.
A lot to unpack here. First of all, the ride on Wessex from Craig Zaki was a beauty.
Mm.
And Ryan's done absolutely nothing wrong on Legato because he's tracked the right horse with Opion into the race, so he's given himself every chance. But she just, as you said, she seemed to labour, and even here she's sort of labouring, and it's almost like the noise from the crowd woke her up and she went, oh, OK, let's go to work. And I don't want to overstate this because you can make a fool of yourself, but it was a little bit Winx-like to me, that thing.
Had to be seen to be believed, yeah.
And knowing where the post was and obviously incredible leg speed, she's not Winx, we know that. I'm not saying she's going to be Winx, but that's similar type thing which Levante has in her as well.
Mm.
Very impressive. We're going to see Wild Knight in a second, so before we compare the two, we'll watch the other race as well. But it does make you wonder whether she's actually going to be a 2,000-metre horse eventually, because that opens up a whole range of doors and a whole range of things later in life. But it was quite magical. I think every big race day needs a moment where everybody goes, wow, and that was clearly that moment. Yesterday.
If she'd been beaten yesterday, you would have said, God, what a run. That was unbelievable. She was so unlucky. But just the fact that she able to lift herself from an impossible, near impossible position to win was just remarkable.
Well, maybe it'll wake her up mentally too, because the reason she was at Pukekohe yesterday is because the Karaka Million or Karaka Classic in her case is at Pukekohe. And I think Ryan did nothing wrong, but I think everybody was expecting her to win. And when you expect them to win, you can be made to look a fool if the leaders don't come back to you. So I think that might wake her up mentally as a horse as well.
Mm.
She's incredibly exciting.
And
this is the clash that AETR needed for Karaka Million. Because it's going to be harder to get people to leave central Auckland to go to Pukekohe. We know that it's going to be harder to get a crowd there. But when people go, her, against the horse we're about to see.
Gets very juicy, doesn't it?
Well, it's a little bit of Aegon versus Amarillinia from the start of last year,
right,
where the three-year-old race almost usurped the two-year-old race. I'm not saying that's going to happen because we'll talk about the two-year-olds later, but that's one half of the draw card. Here's the other half.
Yeah, let's have a little look at the other half, which was, of course, Wild Knight, who continues his picket fence of wins. Here's his Uncle Remus Stakes victory.
Coming after them, Iman to win the Intimidator. Wider out, Wild Knight, and behind them, Davichi Bow, then followed by Channel Surfer. Further back in the field, then is Kabuji at the 200 metres. The Intimidator ranged up to Sacred Satano. Wild Knight being popped the questions. Car starting to charge on the outside now. It's still Sacred Satano, but here comes Wild Knight, the Intimidator lifting. Wild Knight, Sacred Satano giving plenty. Wild Knight just keeps on winning. Wild Knight wins the Uncle Remus second over.
Well, the big fella knows how to win, Opie.
He does. He's quite unassuming. He just does what he has to. Reminds me a lot of Tiako Shark. I know he looks the same, but he's got the same racing style as well.
Was he quite as comfortable this way around as he was at Tarapa and the left-handed starts before that?
There was no problem with him. I think at Avondale Trials, he's probably just a bit fat inside and probably needed the good hit out. So there's nothing wrong with him today.
When you hit the line, he seemed to be going away from them. Is that how it felt? Because halfway up the straight, they half looked to be holding him.
Yeah, they did. I had to really ask for him, but he delivered. So going forward, looking to the mile, it's going to be right up his alley.
Everybody's going to spend the next 3 weeks asking you about Wild Knight versus Legato, so we might as well ask as well.
It's quite exciting. It's good for New Zealand racing. We have two top-class three-year-olds going toe-to-toe, so it's going to be an exciting race.
Yeah, just what we talked about, isn't it? It's the mouth-watering match-up that we're going to get. What did you make of Wild Knight's performance? He just does it, doesn't he? He's not sort of flashy in what he does, but he's workmanlike and he just keeps delivering. So how do you argue with that?
Yes, to all of that. I think he was actually more dynamic, as often horses are, when he was ridden off the speed and the start, and that's when he whooshed like Tiako Shark. I think yesterday they went 121, so they were going quick for 1400. And I think there's not a lot of whooshing to be done when you've raced in the first six on that occasion. I think it's a very strong form race. Mm. I think out of that race, the Intimidator's a good horse. The second horse is a very good horse. I think going right back to fourth, fifth and sixth are good horses. So it's going to be a very strong form race. But the question on everybody's lips straight afterwards is, what do we make of Legato versus Wild Knight? Well, here's what the bookmakers make of it. Both shortened yesterday to close enough to match race odds.
Mm.
What do you make of it? I mean, obviously, I know you want Wild Knight to win, but I think everybody's starting to fall in love with Legato.
Yeah, I mean, how do you argue with an unbeaten record? She does it when she shouldn't win, doesn't she? So very hard to argue with that. I guess a lot of it's going to come down to draws, I think, on the night. Luck, as we saw there with Wessex setting up that blistering tempo, she, you know, had it have been 50 metres shorter, she might not have got there. So, yeah, that's just going to come into play. It's going to be, it's obviously over further, the mile, so that's going to make it even more interesting. But, yeah, I think barrier draws and luck on the night. But Legato's doing things that horses shouldn't do, which you have to respect.
I had a good think about it last night and again this morning and looked at the sectionals. I watched both races about four times this morning over breakfast. I think the difference is this. What I saw yesterday, let's just imagine, as you're looking at this, and we're only talking about Wild Knight, we're not being disrespectful to Sacred Satano and the Intimidator, who are good horses. But when you watch Wild Knight here, just in your mind, just visualise this, put Legato on his back and say to yourself, if Legato was there, could she blow past him here at Pukekohe? Because it's going to be at Pukekohe. And you think of the speed she was going the last 100 metres, the answer to that is probably yes, or at least maybe yes.
Yep.
Reverse that. You put Wild Knight on the back of Legato, and in your mind's eye, do you see Wild Knight running past Legato? And I don't see him running past Legato. Now, I know there's lots of things can happen in the next 3 weeks, and you're right, barrier draws and tracks.
And a high-pressure race, a crack a million, money's up.
Well, I think it'll suit both horses. Yeah. I think them being ridden midfieldish or worse will suit them both.
Mm.
But I just, at the moment, and I'm not trying to get carried away because there's a lot to happen yet, I just don't see Wild Knight being able to run past Legato, where I do, on yesterday, see Legato having the ability to run past Wild Knight, if they're in that situation.
Yeah.
But a couple of years ago, we saw something similar on the railway where Avantage beat Levante and a horse got between them.
Yeah.
And that was a vastly different kettle of fish.
That was luck and running, wasn't it, that day, really?
Exactly. Yeah. And I wish Ryan the best. I hope he gets to 54 and a half.
So do I, yeah.
I think this could be his signature horse. This could be his chance to paint his masterpiece. And I really hope he gets to the 54 and a half. So it's exciting. It's cool, and it's going to give us
what
a reason.
Mm.
Exactly. It's going to give us something to hang our hats on for Karaka Million time. So, pretty exciting for the ATR too, and for everybody at Counties. A lot of hard-working people at Counties are going to have a massive day, which they're probably not used to having,
no.
And they're doing it as a group with ATR. But you can see the people there yesterday, like, they're excited about this opportunity they've got as well.
Yeah, I bet they are. And Boxing Day was a taster for the Karaka Million. Good things to come from Pukekohe on that upcoming night at the end of January. Up next, we take a look at Habana. This is the next race that we touch on in our reviews here on Weigh In. Habana 6 successful in the Brendan and Joe Lindsay colours.
Championship final, and it's Dubai Diva hugging the rail, tackled now by Lady Marole, who went past it. Two lengths away, Habana, Elysian Fields, Miss Ella, then Farrah Leone, followed further back by Blue Moon, warming up nearer the inside at the 200 metres. The pacemaker is Lady Marole. Habana's coming after it, followed then on the inside by Dubai Diva, who's lifting again. Habana went boom at the 100. Habana went to the lead and raced away to win the final. Second
Ullance, Habana continues to improve and has pulled off the biggest intermediate grade race in the country.
Yeah, no, very pleasing. He, he won his last start, he just won it, and I think the penny dropped with him a bit that day. And today he was a bit on his toes, he was feeling well, great ride by Warren, and he won a little bit more comfortably.
Touch of irony, a South African winning on a horse called Habana. Is he actually named after Brian Habana?
Yes, he is, yeah.
There you go. Two South Africans having a day out at Pukekohe. Tell me the backstory to this horse, because he didn't start life with you, did he?
No, he was a horse Cambridge Stud purchased in training off Tony Pike with the hope that he would be able to stay as a stallion prospect. Unfortunately, a couple of little things went wrong and ended up being gelded. But to my good fortune, he's been gelded and sent to the farm, which he loves the farm environment, and he's just had time to mature.
Okay, this has been a good form race for horses to go on and do things at a black type level. So where do you find a decent mile race for him at Blacktop?
Yeah, it may not be this year. It might be next season, but we'll go home and regroup with Brendan and Henry and Joe and go through all the options. But I think he's a horse that will continue to improve. So if we look after him, I'm sure he'll look after us.
You've got a good horse in the railway coming up at Tarapa on Sunday. Is Let's Be Glam all happy and no joint issues, and she's enjoying a life at the moment?
Yeah, really happy with her, how she's gone in the last since her win here at Counties. She galloped well between races last week at Tarapa, and we've got her in a pretty good spot.
Great to see Lance Noble getting success there with Habana. And, of course, we must mention Warren Kennedy. A fantastic day for him. I know we touched him after the Group 1, but really is sort of asserting himself as a force to be reckoned with in New Zealand.
Well, a treble to end the day in a Group 1, $100,000 race, and a lovely ride in the last on the card. And gee, he's a pro to deal with. We've got some great riders here. You know, Opie, Nava, obviously Craig Grills is leading the premiership, and plenty of others. But both Craig, even in defeat on Wessex and when he won earlier, we'll see Craig Zaki later on, these boys know what they're doing. There's absolutely no doubt about that. And it adds to us. They're going to get rides in both Karaka Million races. There's no doubts about that. Interesting horses. He's by Zoo Star. We don't have a lot of Zoo Stars in New Zealand. And obviously he was, as Lance said, purchased potentially as a stallion. Lots of colts syndicates going around and not many make it. But as a gelding, he's doing a great job. He's won 4 from 8. You would suggest he can turn up in a decent mile race somewhere. It's too soon for the Rich Hill, but there's no reason to think this time next year he won't be a Rich Hill type horse. Thought the second horse was really good too. That'll be, again, a strong race, but I'm not sure what to make of it. It's, again, a race where you need to look at a lot of replays in, because horses who finish 10th in that are going to turn up somewhere in 3 weeks and just brain a normal rating 75 field.
Yeah, we need to watch those replays, get those black bookers noted down after Boxing Day's races. We also had the listed Hallmark Stud Handicap on the programme on Boxing Day, and the successful horse in this one was Synchronised with another import jockey in Craig Zaki.
lead at the 450, and behind them, Al Vencedor has a gap if good enough, then looking to run on. Now we've got out wide here, La Bella Beals, followed by Rocket Science, further back and behind these now, Sassy Merlot at the 200. It's Green A on the one to catch La Bella Beals, and here's Synchronized coming after them very quickly. Synchronized dropped in on them and went clear. Synchronized from in second spot, Green A on, and then followed by El Vencedor, but Synchronized a win. Second over is...
Look, she's got a bit of speed, this horse.
She does. I said she had obviously a hiccup her last start, and today was just basically getting her to breathe in the running, getting her to relax and to finish off the race. And Mark assured me she's got the ability, she's a prep horse, but it all depends if I can just get her settled and breathing, that should give that firing kick. And I mean, you're spot on. I was a little bit further back than I wanted to be, but she came into the straight. I just needed a little gap to open, and she just bombed through it. So a good win overall.
Craig, you're getting a lot of the right sorts of colours on your back. Some of the biggest trainers in New Zealand supporting you. That must be very gratifying when you're not suspended.
Exactly, yeah. The Whipple took time for me to learn and to control, but I think after this I've focused a lot on it. I'm learning, and I'm going to try just be as neat as I can. But yeah, racing's been great, getting a lot of support, getting a lot of rides wherever I go, and that definitely plays a big role into your confidence, and it just really helps out. You know, you're going to put in the work, and you just want to keep doing everything right. So with the support, it's all credit to everyone out there.
Is it hard as a very experienced rider to have to relearn part of your craft because of the different rules?
It is. I've done things a certain way for 11 years, and you come here and the rules are the same, but one or two tweaks in it where it can make a big difference out there. You have to start counting now and multitasking, and I think that was the part where I just lacked, but I'm getting the grip of it now, and it normally comes quickly, so I'm learning quick and I'm enjoying it.
How are the Zaki family enjoying New Zealand? I think they've been here about 6 weeks now. Everybody's happy?
Oh, they're loving it. The little one, the fiance, it's been an absolutely great lifestyle for them. They can go out and have fun without worrying about me, but they're just loving it, and all around, it's just a happy place here.
Oh, great to hear that Craig Zaki and his family are settling in well to New Zealand life. And Synchronize is an interesting horse, isn't it? Because obviously had that bleeding attack, as you mentioned to me when we were watching that interview, and just effortless on the line with the ears pricked and did it really nicely.
Yeah, awfully fast. I mean, you know, and often see sprinters just drop in and win like that. You'd think that a next start would be the Concord, which is obviously on Karaka Million night, but... No reason to think the way she found the line here. Look at Craig back in the field. He's really holding her up. That she couldn't extend to a 1400 for the Westbury if they want to go that way in the future or another stage. But, you know, this is dramatic stuff. Second horse was really good. Catherine Cameron's doing a super job with Green A on. Old Catherine and Todd, obviously. And Funny Girl got some black type. So it's done its job as well. El Vencedor crawled by the weights there because they had to carry...
Fashion Shoot, unlucky. One for the black book as well.
Midfield. Got back and a lot of horses in front of it and stuff. I like Craig as a rider. Very neat when you watch him ride. Him and Warren, even though they're both South Africans, ride very differently, very different styles, but really like Craig as a rider. And I can understand how he would struggle with our interpretations of the whip rules, because as you said, he's been doing something professionally for a long time and now he has to do it slightly differently. But you can see in that conversation him, he's really determined to work on that to give himself the best opportunities. I think both those boys are going to end up getting rides in pretty much every Group 1 or every Karaka Million race we have heading forward, because there's that clump of the leading New Zealand jockeys, and then those two just fit really nicely into it. And I think with the age and experience they have, the trainers love that feedback.
Yeah.
So they've very quickly ingratiated themselves into our racing situation, which wouldn't have been easy to do.
No.
So lots to like about having them here. Synchronise where she ends up. I don't really know. She'll run out of targets pretty quickly, because after the Concord, we'll have, there's a Group 3 sprint for her at the Cup Carnival, and then there's not that many other big sprint races around. So hopefully she holds together, because she's had the one bleed. obviously if that happens again, she has to be retired.
Yeah, Black Type win beside her name with that listed success in the Hallmark Stud Handicap. It was a really good day for Team Tiakau. They also were successful in the two-year-old event. Here's a little look at Tokyo Tycoon, who looks a leading chance for the two-year-old Karaka Million.
Pounds. Wider out then we've got Rhetorical, further back Farovello and Pender Bell, still spotting them, five lengths at the 250. Tokyo Tycoon ranged up to Viva Vienna, who's kicking again on the inside, two lengths away and Pender Bell starting to warm up, but Tokyo Tycoon took the lead at the 100 and drew clear from Viva Vienna and Pender Bell and Farovello. Tokyo Tycoon, that's two from two for the flashy guy. Tokyo Tycoon, too good.
He looks very professional and pretty darn good.
Yeah, he's a there's not much of him, but he's a really genuine little racehorse, and he won nicely today, so he doesn't have to do a huge amount more. He'll head straight to the Cracker Millions.
When do we start seeing decisions around who Opie Bosson will ride on the Cracker Million?
He's riding a horse called Trobriand at New Year's Day, and then he'll make up his mind after that. I'm pretty sure he'll ride either one of those two, because they get a higher weight as well, so that'll probably come into play.
Do you have any idea about the pecking order for the juveniles now, or do you wait till after New Year's Day at Tarapa, Mark?
I think you wait till after the race at Tarapa, and just, you know, there'll some nice horses there as well.
We've seen in the past, Tiakau haven't been scared to line up horses sort of a week and a half out, or about 2 weeks out from the Karaka Million. Is there a chance some of the team won't be declared until then?
We've still got Believe in Magical run on Sunday the 8th, 2 weeks before, so, and she ran second in the Wakefield at Wellington, so you know, she's a genuine chance as well.
Do you have any idea how many you think you'll have in the Karaka Million, Mark?
I think probably six, possibly seven, yeah.
Okay, we know one of them's going to be ridden by Opie Bosson. Are you corralling around for riders at the moment? Any chance we might see an Australian rider on one of yours?
Yeah, definitely some of the Aussie boys will be here, so we'll just have to work it out a bit close to the time.
Pretty exciting stuff, isn't it? Here's a look at the market, which is obviously really important as we see these two-year-olds stepping out and it all becomes a little bit clearer. Tokyo Tycoon and Ice Mover 12s into 350. What did you make of Pender Bell? Obviously, we heard from Mark about Tokyo Tycoon. It was a clinical win, very professional. Is Pender Bell a horse you're still keen on heading towards a Karaka Million?
I think a bit of draw would help. Got quite far back and just seemed to get on the wrong leg and got lost, and then they had to come back across the back of the field. Still obviously a factor in this race, but I think it's a very even Karaka Million. In fact, the most even Karaka Million I think we've had. Mm. I don't even think the Tiakau horses have sorted themselves out yet. And then Ulanova's really good and Ethereal Star's really good. So wait. That's all we can do is wait. And we don't have to wait too long. The next significant race is the Trobriand race coming up Tarapa on Sunday. So we'll know more after that, but yeah, very even. Barrier draws crucial. Riders crucial. Some of the big names there don't have riders as of yet. I know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it because you're married to Opie. Does he have any idea who he's riding, and does he tell you?
No, he doesn't tell me at all. I'm the last to know about what he's
so
doing.
If I ring him and he tells me at some stage,
tell
should
me,
I ring you and tell you?
Text me, please.
That's good.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
We're bonding over this.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to get you off to a break here on Wayne, and we leave you with a stakes race coming in from Wingatui, and it was, of course, the Hazlitt Stakes.
On. Boyd to the outside of the track. Now he's coming after them quickly. The favourite letting go. Wider OK Power. The Radiant One runs up behind them. And now Lightning Jack running on Boyd. Boyd, the favourite, takes the lead. Here's Lightning Jack. OK Power, the Radiant One. Boyd's in front of the Hazlitt. Corey Campbell punches him out. Boyd is brilliant.
You by our stable of sponsors.
Yo, VIP, let's kick it.
Ice, ice, baby. Ice, ice, baby.
All right, stop, collaborate and listen. Ice is back with my brand new invention. Something grabs a hold of me tightly, flow like a harpoon daily and nightly.
Will it ever stop?
Yo, I
extreme. I rock a mic like
if
a
there's something we love on this show, it is taking the mickey out of Michael. And today, you've delivered. You delivered to the viewers
the
that
of respect.
Epic.
The lack of respect as I am now one of the senior members of the New Zealand Racing Media Fraternity is so disappointing. If I'd known that was going to happen, I would have shaved.
Oh, awesome. Dear.
I wasn't expecting
you love an ice cream with a sprinkle. Clearly.
Look, just to clarify this for anybody considering going to Pukekohe, the ice cream is outstanding. So there you go.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think it's a new segment.
Oh, there'll be a payback.
The taking the mickey out of Michael
bobblehead
segment.
At some stage.
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah. If you've got some good vision of Michael, send it in to us.
No, absolutely do not do that. Absolutely do not do that. I know who you are.
Okay, let's move along. It's you weigh in. Let's get to that next. Well, a big congratulations goes to Vicky Steele this week. Vicky has nominated the TAB for the 12 Days of Sportsmas promotion. She's finding it a lot of fun. She hasn't won yet, but she's really enjoying the promotion. So well done to the TAB. And to Vicky, you've won something because you've won our You Weigh In segment. $100 bonus bet is coming to you. Well done to you for that result.
Hey, Em, just by the way, we saw Buoyant winning the Hazlitt on the way to the break. There was an accident involving a horse truck on the way home from Wingatua yesterday. That was Michael Pittman. Michael and a staff member called Mabel, whose last name I do not know, were not seriously injured. They did not need hospitalisation, so they were fine. The horses, speaking to Matthew Pittman this morning, seven horses, they're okay. Some skin off some of them. One of them may need proper vet treatment, but the horse is okay, Michael and Mabel okay. So what could have been a very bad situation worked out not too badly.
Yeah, exactly right. So I'm glad everybody's okay as a result of that. Matamata Trials is what we get to next. There was a couple of really key trials at Matamata before the races. And here's a look at both of those. This is trial one. Babylon Berlin features in this one over the 1,000 metres. And Michael, what are we taking away from this one?
Babylon Berlin in front, Levante into second. And Levante jumped well. So these are the catch weight trials before the races on Friday. Bonnie Lass really good. Just everybody's happy. Everybody I spoke to said I was happy with what my horse did, but I think the happiest was Ken Kelso with Levante because she jumped well, and that means she may not give them a huge start in the railway, which is on Sunday at Tarapa. Here's Imperatrice. Now, this is Imperatrice looming up outside Johnny Johnny, and Johnny Johnny's very quick. They were happy with Imperatrice. I thought, to be honest, she should have got past Johnny Johnny. And I know it's a trial, but I thought Levante was better to the eye than Imperatrice. For what it's worth, that's only one person's opinion, for what might be an early contender for the race of 2023. This M is hot. Mm. That's a cool-looking field. This is Sunday at Tarapa. Barry draws out Wednesday.
Yeah, super exciting, isn't it? Levante, obviously the favourite there, 270, Imperatrice fives in that market, and just a number of really key contenders in that. We also want to have a little look at the QE2 market as well, I think, as a build-up to what's going to come up over the next week or so.
Well, this has lost a couple of the top weights. So Defibrillate came out, then Sidorama became the next top weight, and she's out now because she's retired. So the weights for this race, some of the horses who might have thought they might get 55, all of a sudden might end up on 57. Again, very even, different type of race, but plenty of form coming out of there. We've had recent form through a lot of these horses. Victor Vegas has been great, Dionysus has been great, Self-Obsession, a lot, good even type of a race. I think we're in for a stunning day at Tarapa on Sunday.
Yeah, I have to agree with you with regards to that. We also, Michael, have a little announcement around the Hall of Fame. Of course, it's such a wonderful part of the industry and something people really sort of aspire to. And there's a couple of new announcements as to two people heading in there.
Yeah, well, Cherry Taylor, who's a member of the Hall of Fame board, has kindly let us announce the next two inductees into the Hall of Fame. So the Hall of Fame dinner will be on May the 7th. It's a long way away, but a chance to book your tickets. Two wonderful names from New Zealand Racing. Paul O'Sullivan, recently back from Hong Kong, will be inducted into the Hall of Fame. Paul, to you and the family, congratulations. I know how proud everybody will be. And the other inductee, talking of proud families, is Opie Bosson. So Opie is going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. I know that's super cool for you. Yesterday, I spoke to Opie to find out what it means, and Who's helped him along the way?
Well, Opie, the news is out now. You're going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. You probably look a bit young to be inducted into the Hall of Fame, but J-Mac's in there and he's younger than you.
Yeah, J-Mac got in pretty early. But it's an honour to be recognised for what I've done in the saddle.
It's one of those things, I suppose, when you start riding, you never think you're going to be in the Hall of Fame.
No, but it's always something I really, really wanted to prove, and I just hope my family's really proud of me.
I'm sure they are. You've won, I think, Aidan Rodley tells me, every Group 1 race in New Zealand. Was that also something you wanted to do, or are those type of goals a little bit too lofty to talk about much when you're younger?
Yeah, well, you can't really say you want to win every single Group 1 when you're young, but when I got close to it, I knew there were a couple I hadn't done, so once I ticked it all off, I was quite pleased.
I know a couple of years ago you thought, shall I still keep doing this? Can I keep the weight off? Is it much fun anymore? You seem to be enjoying it. You seem to be having a good time out there. You seem to be riding really well. Are you feeling invigorated? Are you going to be around for a couple more years?
I think I'll be around for a few more years, but every morning when I hop out of the bath, I think this is the last time, but the winners give you a great tonic.
Mate, who's helped you get to the Hall of Fame?
David Ellis has been a big, and Tiaka Racing have been a big part of it. Stephen Ortridge, Murray Baker, and of course my wife. She's a great supporter of mine, and I wouldn't be achieving what I have achieved without all those people.
Very smart to say that, because she'll be in the studio when we air this tomorrow, so that was very smooth.
got to keep the brownie points.
I was so terrified. I was thinking, if he does not mention Emily in the speech,
I'm going
to have to dig him. I would have had to go like,
off camera.
Wedding, wife, yeah. No,
What?
He was. Look, I know it means a lot to him. It must mean a lot to you as well. It's a wonderful honour. And on the show, we're going to get the chance to announce a couple more of the inductees. That dinner's on May the 7th. I believe you're emceeing the dinner.
I know, so which is quite special, yeah.
It'll be amazing to be a part of it, like,
in that way. Yeah, I think anybody who I've spoken to about the Hall of Fame has said it's so nice to be respected by your peers. That's what makes it so important. And that for Opie is so significant, to be recognised for what it is.
To him and to Paul, and there are a few more inductees we're going to announce on way. And so Cherry and the team there, thank you for giving us the opportunity to do that, and we'll profile them more coming up. But yeah, congratulations to you, to Opie, and yeah, it's a pretty cool moment.
Yeah, it most definitely is. We're going to get you to a break on way, and on the back of that, we spend a little time remembering Colin Gillings.
Is brought to you by our stable of sponsors.
You're back with us on Weigh-In, and it's now time to remember Colin Gillings, such an important and huge part of our New Zealand racing industry. And we caught up with David Ellis to find out more about him.
Well, the passing of an icon, David Ellis. Colin Gillings, a man you knew well, a man who everybody in New Zealand racing revered.
Yeah, he was just an absolute champion person. And a legend of the turf. I've never met a man that was such great company, that was such a great judge of horses, and every December I used to take him to my stable and I used to show him 10 or 15 of the best horses, and I'm saying, this is what we're thinking of doing with that horse. This is what we're thinking of doing with that horse. He'd say, you're wasting your time with that horse, you're on track with that horse. And he was just an incredible judge of knowing what to do, and he was right 99 times out of 100.
David, do you believe that was experience, or having had so many good horses, or is that an inherent thing which some people just have?
He was just born with it. He rode his first winner when he was 12 years of age at Ellerslie. He loved talking about it. Won the railway when he was at Ellerslie, when he was still a teenager. He was an unbelievable horseman, and I'd never forget a funny story at Ellerslie one day. He said to me, you know, pal, he said, in the last race, he said, you know, I think I'm a real good thing in this. And I said, well, on the tote it's paying $1.50, but fixed odds it's paying $4.80. $4.80? This thing can't get beaten. So for a guy that was on Steve Davis's show telling everybody that his biggest bet was $5 each way on a horse. I couldn't believe to tell you how much he asked me to put on this horse for him. So at the turn, I'm watching this race with him. I said, you're going to win this, Jello, but not with the one we want. The stablemate's going to win it. No, it won't beat this thing. And anyway, the stablemate got up on the outside and beat the horse that we backed. And, I've never seen a trainer Quinella a race and be so filthy on the world.
Why do you think he was a great trainer, apart from the horsemanship? He seemed a man who was very good at planning long-range targets.
Well, firstly, he loved horses, absolutely loved them. And he liked doing everything properly. So he spent a lot of time planning a horse. And he would tell you 6 months out, and I'll never forget, he had a horse called Diamond Lover. And she was in the Rower Handicap, which in those days was on Boxing Day or New Year's Day. And I said, you're not going to start that in the race. It hasn't started for 6 months. Anyway, I realised what his plan was. He took her to the races each Saturday for the previous month and just walked her around for an hour so that she tightened up a little bit. Then he'd give her an exhibition gallop. Come race day, he had a bang on and she absolutely bolted in, and that was a huge result for Patrick and Justine Hogan of Cambridge Stud. It was a big result for him too, because I was with him when he backed her. He was a very good judge.
He came from what feels like a vastly different era, the era of Mr. Gillings, and everybody was Mr. and that sort of thing. But when it was closer to home, it was Powell. Now, you're famous for your Powellisms. He's the man who started for you, the Powell.
Yeah, you've just got no idea what a great person he was. He was such a kind person. I remember about 35 years ago, he said to me, how are you going? I said, oh, I'm really battling, Jello. I said, interest rates are now 22%. And my horses aren't going that well, I'm battling a bit. The next day he sent me 10 horses to adjust, 4 to break in. He was just a wonderful human being. And today, you notice with Wild Knight, Opie had the black armbands on. That was for my dear friend, Colin Gillings.
Obviously, Mr. Gillings and Mrs. Gillings, Alison, had been off the public radar for a while, so some people wouldn't know that Mrs. Gillings actually passed away 6 or 9 months ago, so Colin and her are now back together.
Yes, that's dead right. Alison was a big part of his life. In those days, they'd have 4 or 5 apprentices, and they all lived in the home with them, and she'd have their clothes all washed on race day. She'd have a tie for each apprentice to wear, a jacket for them. She made them all have haircuts and she made them all look the part. She was a massive part in the operation. And one of the great things, he was very competitive at everything he did. And he loved trout fishing. That was really his only hobby. And Peter Grieve, Ivan Grieve, and the late Herbie Dyke and I, we were in the trout fishing team together. And once it came when you could put the lines out, all Jello wanted to do was win that damn tournament. And he concentrated until it was time to pull the lines in, and then it was time to play poker. And he was just a fantastic friend to have. And we won that trout fishing tournament 17 of 21 years. And it was because he was so determined that everything he did in life was win.
David, did he ever tell you who he thought was the best, whether that was Uncle Remus, or obviously McGinty was a personal favourite for many people, or in fact the Phantom Chance? Did you ever have that discussion with him?
Oh, I think the Phantom Chance, if you'd seen his face, I was sitting next to him when he won the Cox Plate. It's hard to get a horse as good as the Phantom Chance was. And the interesting story was, after the sales, he sent the horse to Tiaki out to adjust. And he said, I don't want to see this horse for 12 months. He's a slow maturing horse. So 6 months later, I rang him and I said, you won't believe this horse. He's developed that much since the sales. You've got to get him going now. I'm not saying he'll win a 2-year-old race, but he'll win an early 3-year-old race. And he took a bit of convincing, but when the horse arrived, he said, yeah, he said, this is a Derby horse. And he wasn't wrong. He won the Derby, and he just planned every day with the horse. He was a special, special trainer and a special human being.
Oh, awesome stuff, and a big thank you to David Ellis for taking the time to regale all those wonderful stories about Colin Gillings, and a person who'll be dearly missed within the racing industry.
Yeah, but David and him were very close. Lots of people were close to Mr. Gillings. When I first arrived here to work at the Herald in 1990, Colin Gillings was an icon, one of the few people you were scared of. Like, he was just that famous and that well-known and that well-respected. His body of work is enormous, way before you and I started doing this. But horses like McGinty and the Phantom Chance and Uncle Remus for a younger crowd, they're part of who we are if you're involved in New Zealand racing. And so was Colin Gillings. We've lost two of the icons in one year. Roy Purden in harness racing passed this year, Colin toward the end of the year. These are enormous names which are on the Mount Rushmore of New Zealand racing. So I didn't know Mrs. Gillings had passed. I hadn't spoken to the family for about a year. It's nice they're back together again.
Yeah, exactly right. Really special stuff, and a big thank you to everyone involved in today's show. Awesome stuff coming in, and a big thank you to the team here behind the scenes who worked tirelessly on Boxing Day to put this show together. A big thank you to you. We'll be back next week. A very happy new year. Enjoy your New Year's Eve, and we'll be back to review the New Year's Day races and dissect those group ones.